within Hinduism, you can see Vishnu within the pillar of fire. And, you know, it's quite a complicated equation, having an entity within the pillar of fire. That complicated equation is replicated in the Bible with God speaking within the pillar of fire. In this modernistic Freemasonic depiction, a tracing board depiction, you can see the pillars, and you can see that both the smoke or cloud, as per the Bible, and the fire, the pillars, are represented there. So there's an inextricable link right there in front of your eyes. And the link of the person as the pillar, as per the Caryatids, and as the tree also, you know, you see the tree flowing within the pillar also. All of these things are linked. It's just probably a bit too much for people, even people studying this occult stuff. It's too much to kind of take on. And the notion of the person as the pillar also, probably too much to take on for most people. But nonetheless, it's depicted here, there, and everywhere, and the Masons can joke about it, and I think rightly so. You have, like, with the fire pillar, you have the monument to the Great Fire of London, with the pillar there and the fire, and you can see what are perhaps the elementals emerging out of that pillar also. Now, the person also. So, how do, if the pillar is a person, how does anything emerge from it? Well, you can look at even going to Egypt here with this, like this drawing. You can see the entities around the bottom, and within France here, you can see even the Sphinx emerging through the a portal in a way from that pillar. Now, if that's you, are you a portal? And you can see various depictions of because you have the tree of life running through you, the chakra system, and all the rest of it. And in a way, these appear to be interdimensional channels as well. And from these come various entities and so forth. So strangely enough, you are a portal also, which is totally, totally unbelievable. And as a high Freemason said to me, this stuff is unbelievable. Now, whether I'm completely correct here or not, that's another story. But anyway, as he said, the public would never believe it. But
you must unlock your full potential.
Did you locate the Temple of Light?
Now, if you went to the Olympics in London in 2012, you had the sort of fire figure there in the center of the circle. Also, pillars of fire here, there, and everywhere, basically. Lego got right into it as well. This is from the Olympics team, Great Britain. And you have the figures. Now, there's a whole lot you can say about here because the floor drops away, the perception of the floor, and I could read to this, but I don't think I'll be doing that in this video. But anyway, and you have the fire pillar in the center there with Lego, and then if you look at this configuration, you have the same thing with the four around the one and the fire, the tree, the burning bush, the fire pillar still in the center. And I've shown this many times where you have the pillar in the center, which would also be in part an imbuement of fire, if you will, in the center with the figure in the center, the four around the one from Ninjago. If we go to Melbourne, you have another pillar there, very similar in a way to the great, to that monument to the Great Fire of London, with this pillar in Russell Street. And you can see once again the entities coming out, and you can see a reference to fire there also. So this emergence from the pillar, this emergence from the person. As it happens in Melbourne, there's also an installation on the street titled Red Centre from 2006. And reading at the plaque, you can see the reference there to fire and flame. Now, the Red Centre in Australia would be the kind of red dirt in the centre of Australia, the red desert, if you will. But anyway, so, and also there a meeting place, also a meeting place, because within esoteric circles, we're not just dealing with humans here, even though that is just unbelievable to your average person on the street. And just on that notion for a bit, this reference here out of the Bible kind of explains it as well as anything. So it reads, "For who is there of all flesh?" so of all flesh. So these are the people that just believe in the flesh side of things, the bricks and mortar of modern society, which is what we're all taught to learn, and that is it. This is those people, and this is all the people who will just not be able to get what I'm kind of speaking to here. And I don't blame people, because they're not part of secretive societies in a way, and also they've never encountered any interdimensional light of any sort, so forth and so forth. Perhaps apart from your dreams and those sorts of things, where there's that side of it as well. But anyway, for who is there of all flesh? All flesh, and that's believing in flesh, it's believing in just the physical. So, for who is there of all flesh that have heard the voice of the living God speaking out of the midst of the fire as we have and lived?
The four-sided nature of the magician. From the first step is from the physical. The work the mage has done has taken his awareness into the astral. He's already an adept in the astral. But this ritual takes, when we'll go back to the animation, when this process starts happening, the mage then assumes a four-sided reality. The mage then assumes a four-sided reality. The mage then assumes a four-sided reality.
Whilst it's probably too much to take, this symbology applies to you.
Then assumes a four-sided. The mage then assumes a four-sided reality. And that we have, in fact, a physical face and a face for all the elements. And when we allow our consciousness to be split into fourfold nature, a void appears in our consciousness, and in that void our mental reality, our internal dialogue stops. And we disappear within that void within ourselves and reappear and condense in the next plane. You can see very thick bandwidths between these planes on the board. And it takes a lot of psychic energy, a lot of prana to manifest a jump of awareness between the planes.
So along the themes of the physical body and the astral body, or the etheric double, if you will, I'll just read here about the cable toe, that you'll see in initiation within Freemasonry. So this emblem of the cable toe has also been considered to typify the psychic umbilical cord, the connecting thread of matter which joins the etheric double to the dense physical body when the former is temporarily partially withdrawn from the latter. So you can see the partial withdrawal of from the physical body of the lesser body, the etheric double, if you will. Reading on, so thus the silver cord there. So the silver cord mentioned in the well-known biblical passage as being definitely loosed at death. So that was the etheric body sort of leaving the physical at death there. So Bro Wilmshurst tells us that silver is the technical esoteric term for the psychical substance, as gold is for spiritual and iron or brass for physical. He suggests also that the cable toe is intended to hint to us that all the true and higher initiations take place out of the physical body. Very important lines right there. I found this illustration with some Masonic writing on the net. Of course, you can see the physical and the etheric double right there.
The mage then assumes a four-sided reality, and the mage finds his four faces, a face for each one of those globes, and then at that point energies move both up and down, and There is a shift in consciousness and awareness within the context of the magic circle or the ritual or the sacred space that's been created by either the single practitioner or the mage. And at that point, at that the dynamo of energy that's created is enough to jolt the energy of the mage into the next ring. And I'll go back to the still again. And at that point, these things all collect.
Regarding this collect aspect, further within the Cirque du Soleil footage, you can see the orbs going back into the mage as described. Now, the guest certainly didn't know about this at the time. Not even I knew about it within the Cirque du Soleil footage. It's a very quick thing within the footage, so it's very hard to notice.
At that point, these things all collect, and the collect and the consciousness and awareness of the magician moves into this next fifth ring. You can see it's blank there. It's ready to receive the next reality or the next octave up of this ritual. In the first octave, it's in the astral, and we have these globes or spheres. In the next octave, this globe encases and forms an egg-like structure around the mage, and then
that would be what we perhaps refer to as the spirit orb.
A spirit orb, and yep. And in the first octave it's an orb. In the second octave it forms an egg structure around the magician rather than being above the magician's head, and that's in that fifth ring. So, and in the fourth ring, it forms a tube. The egg, the top and bottom of the egg opens out, and it forms a tube or a channel. In the second octave, it forms an egg structure. So, and in the fourth ring, it forms a tube. In the fourth ring, it forms a tube. The egg, the top and bottom of the egg opens out, and it forms a tube or a channel. The tube or a channel. And you could say that this first ring represents the base or the physical plane or the base chakra. This next ring represents the astral plane where this ritual, this stage of this ritual is occurring.
Yeah.
And that's happening in the astral.
Within occultism and within the ritual scenario, there is a stage where the physicality is kind of lost, if you will. For the rest of us, we have to battle with what I call the physical lock. And you're just bound to things physical. You look at a pillar, you see stone. You can't see light because it is what it is. You see the human body, you just think of the textbook and biology and these sorts of things. You see the blood cells and all the rest of it and blood. And that's it. You can't think beyond that. But anyway, speaking beyond that, taking away the physical, if you look at the tree running through the body, that is the chakra system, you will see here that Ledbetter has made the ends of it sort of look like kind of the petals, the lotus petals, if you will. And you kind of have those kind of as the chakras also in a way also. So these would be portals in a way, strangely enough. If we look at the Cirque du Soleil footage of Julien, you can see that he brings, well, the orbs are brought out of that system from the base chakra. The same would apply in the runescape in that ritual also, where in this case, the magicians are working from the outside of the circle and putting the energy inwards, different rituals. So anyway, you have that tree going through the body. Now, we'll just look at the cornucopia for a moment, and with these images, we can see that it intertwines with the tree also, with the foliage also, and with these images you can kind of see the caduceus like formation there also, the kind of Ida and Pingala, if you will, the nadi, the currents going through the body. So it's all kind of intertwined in a way, and you can see that both with the lotus, you can see the entities coming sort of out of the lotus, if you will, that portal way. You can also see that with the cornucopia as well. It's kind of the same thing, they're one and the same. With these images, you can see from the base chakra, you can see the cornucopia there sort of pointing, the end of it sort of pointing at that base chakra where those orbs came out, for example. pointing at that base chakra where those orbs came out, for example. In this image, you can kind of see the foliage kind of flowing out from the person. You can also see the extensions of that out of the body as well, that kind of the thread going out to the lotus and all that sort of thing that's shown with the tree of Jesse, that sort of thing. You can see the lotuses, kind of lotus lilies sort of held in the hands, so extensions from the hands also. The same would apply with the same sort of scenario with the cornucopia as well, and you know, entities coming from these. Now, while we're at all this, with this tree of life coming out of the human body, if you will, these portals, strangely enough, there would be another aspect to this, and that is that there would be further entities, cherubim-like, and I'm not going to say that, I don't want to get into the specifics of this, but you see these all around the people within the rituals and all the rest of it, and this goes on and on and on and on and on and on and on. But that, and I think Wayne Herschel may have got this right with his strange experience, but anyway, so that these, that the cherubim, and you can see this across different cultures and all the rest of it in Egypt and across to India, and that the cherubim are the ones manipulating, and there are plenty of cases of manipulating these portal ways. And this is part of what I can see going on here within the images. The cherubim as manipulators of these etheric interdimensional tubes that would be portals as well, I would deeply suspect. I will leave it at this, and bye for now.